Ladies and gentlemen, I've been asked to start the second session, so if you can all take your places, we'll begin. This session will have a similar format to the preceding one. First, I've been asked to talk for about 20 minutes, giving some of the background of how Eastern Europe on Caucasus views the EU. Then, already assembled, we have a very high quality panel of experts and practitioners from the region. They've both served in government and they're both good men for ideas. So we'll have plenty of lofty thoughts and practical recommendations. So my opening address is called Seven Deadly Sins, or Seven Reasons Why Europe Gets the Russia-Ukraine Crisis Wrong. We've just seen the REAP summit held last week. Very much a typical product of a method born in the EU's internal politics, where doing nothing or seeking compromise, maybe making marginal adjustments in the hope of changing policy next time, is often the only way to proceed. This, however, is not an adequate approach to the scale of the problems faced, and I'll try and explain why. These seven deadly sins are general, but I'm trying to focus on the kind of East European point of view. The first, bureaucratism, or a Europe of too many rules. I will begin unoriginally. My colleague Volodymyr Jermolenko wrote last year a highly recommended piece called Dreams of Europe, in which he contrasted the Europe of rules to the Europe of values. And I quote, "There is the Europe that presents a more or less emotionless face of rules and regulations. This Europe ends somewhere along the frontier between Germany and Poland. A kind of Euro-Protestantism prevails. It has lost faith in European civilization, but preserved its sense of morality. The European idea has been transformed into a set of rules and a collection of institutional procedures. Where there is no faith, rules become paramount. The other Europe is spontaneous and emotional, the Europe of faith. This is young Europe, consisting in the main of the countries of the former socialist bloc. The people living in these countries, Europe is still a vision, an ideal utopia." End of quote. This is a useful distinction which I'd like to take further. I see at least four related problems with this Europe of rules. First, old Europe can't think beyond rules. It no longer has any grand projet or moral élan. It sits behind the forest of thorns that is the acquis communautaire. Second, the rules-based approach of the Eastern Partnership is based on a fundamental misunderstanding of how post-Soviet societies actually work. They are anti-Weberian. The EU is founded on the Weberian assumption that rules are applied by rational and benign bureaucracies, and that rules are Kantian, in the sense that they are universally applicable and applied fairly and blindly. But this is not how rules function in post-Soviet societies. Rules are deliberately arbitrary. The law is deliberately capricious. There is a Russian phrase, the law is for our enemies. For our friends, everything is permitted. Bureaucracy is a sinecure, a means of extracting rent from the hapless general public. When government positions are sold openly and come with a price list, you know something is wrong or different. So the EU's Eastern Partnership offer of more rules doesn't actually make sense unless politics is first changed locally and unless local states and political cultures are changed first. The EU should start by trying to strengthen the rule of law, not the misrule of local bureaucracies. If a tipping point is achieved towards the rule of law, rules can help reining corruption and rent seeking. If not, they can actually make things worse by strengthening local autocracies. De facto, EU policy is a form of autocratic modernisation. Third, if EU rules are for export, they're a hard sell in a competitive market. Russia has its alternative offer, as I'll explain, and places like Ukraine are at war and in need of much more emotional and engaged politics. Fourth, the rules are too often hollow. The EU assumes that states like Ukraine are more interested in declaration than implementation, but maintain the rule export process anyway. I heard so many times in private in early 2013 the same thought. We must sign the agreement with Ukraine, we don't expect Yanukovych to actually implement it. This is dangerous to say. It's therefore pretty obvious what's wrong with the Eastern Partnership, that the offer of rules and an apparatus checking compliance with those rules has created a giant donor-beneficiary relationship, with the EU as the giant donor and Eastern Europe as a kind of collective miasma of NGOs. Second sin, this Europe of values, and Europe of a variable geography. Although the EMP exists for both East and South and has not been formally split, the Eastern Partnership implicitly acknowledges a difference. The East is assumed to be vaguely but indeterminately European, in a way the South is not currently. The northern, western and southern borders of Europe are supposed to be clear, it's only the eastern border that we're not sure about. But this East is capable of becoming more clearly European by making the right values commitments. So the problem is one of wavering commitment. This vague and permeable border in the East might be thought of to be an advantage for the six Eastern Partnership states. But the assumptions of the model are terribly wrong. Historically, Europe's borders have never been clear in any direction. All of Europe's nation states have varied over time in their commitment to Europe. And so-called European values are doubly new. Western Europe only embraced democracy after 1945, and not everybody, and only embraced multiculturalism, gradually, and still not everybody, after 1968. Whereas all European states, East and West, define themselves by history and geography as well. Histories that are much older than 1945. And a history of variable, instrumental and often opportunistic relations with Europe is also true of all East and West. So it's not just Eastern European states that have sometimes been part of Europe and sometimes not. So has everybody else. The idea that only the eastern border of Europe is undefined is also ahistoric. In the south, the Greco-Roman world invented the idea of Mediterranean, which was the reverse of today's Europe. Instead of the frugal north against the profligate south, it was the south that was civilized and the north that was barbarian. In this world, Romania and Georgia were more European than Germany and Poland. Also, every European state has more or less three alternative identities. Some have more if they were once empires as well. There are nativist myths that place individual nations on their own. There are kinship myths used to build alliances, the idea of Scandinavia or of North versus South, Protestant, Catholic, etc. And there are identities that link any given nation to Europe. The choice between them depends on circumstance, both in East and West. Now, Georgia has seen something of a recent return of nativism after the highly westernizing Saakashvili era. But there is also change in the West. An independent Scotland will have slightly bizarre freedom to choose amongst its historical identities. Celtic identity doesn't really make sense in terms of the SNP's likely allies in its kind of left of centre political culture. So it will probably emphasise Scotland's alternative to Scandinavian instead, which is not entirely fictitious. Europe, therefore, is both chicken and egg. If Europe is a success, it's attractive, both to potential new members and within the current borders of the EU. Even advocates of a wider Europe, with whom I'm naturally sympathetic, have it the wrong way round. They assume the European project will be complete when it ticks all the boxes, when it has expanded to include all parts of the objective Europe. In fact, it is the relative success of subjective Europe that determines how Pole states choose between their wider identities. If the EU is a success, in other words, it will get big. If not, they will shrink. Third sin, mercantilism. There is a recession paradox. The more that EU standards of living have been threatened since 2008, the keener we are to preserve them. At a focus group I was at in Kyiv in April, one comment was, Western politicians live and die by tenths of GDP. We Ukrainians are prepared to endure the wreck of our economy, even though you are so much richer. Possibly exaggerated, all Ukrainians are so committed, but the point is clear. And it's not just that EU Europeans are materialist. Mercantilism is essentially a philosophy of marginal gain, predicated on the assumption of stable politics. But at the moment, the politics is unstable so the maths fails to add up. France defends the Mistral contracts worth 1.7 billion. Western companies have lost 10, 20, 40 times that amount in Russia from missed investment opportunities, trade wars, and so on, because the politics are wrong. Fourth sin. Well, actually, three intellectual sins. Seen from the Eastern Partnership states, so-called modern European values are not necessarily the values of Weber or Kant, but the values of postmodern Europe. The crisis has exposed the limits of moral or even factual relativism, the product of the intellectual revolution since 1968. Three sins that I would define, slightly pronounced awkwardly. One is, what about is it? What about X? What about Y? We cannot criticise A because B is the same, which all too easily becomes a disarming, non-judgmental pacifism. The opposite, or permissive form of this paradigm is, if America can do X or Europe can do X, then why can't we do it too? Russia is particularly adept at framing its actions in this kind of mirror image way. Crimea, they claim, is the same as Kosovo, etc. Second intellectual sin is a product of the first, an aversion to moral clarity. Whataboutism kind of precludes what should be easy judgment. I will quote Ukrainian writer Julian, 2014, in his speech in receipt of the Hannah Arendt Prize. My foreign acquaintances doubt. To doubt is an altogether positive trait of a true European. My acquaintances are true Europeans, so they also doubt. They ask me, is it possible that good is only on one side and evil on the other? Isn't the truth always somewhere in the middle, or at least in between? Postmodern consciousness excludes a black and white approach. My acquaintances are looking for villains on both sides of the conflict. And he was specifically referring to the conflict in Ukraine, where the Western view of events is so often distorted by a constant search for balance. Ukrainians often see a simpler picture, preferring to err on the side of moral clarity. It was possibly an overused paradigm, But it was very interesting during the Euromaidan protests to see how social media used popular Western European cultural tropes. The Yanukovych regime was Mordor from Lord of the Rings. The final confrontation in Kiev was like the final showdown, the final Harry Potter book, i.e. presenting the image in much clearer black and white terms. A third intellectual fault, it's all our fault, is it? According to which the West provoked Russia by NATO expansion or some other sin. This is false moral piety and a narrowing of moral agency to the self. Fault never lies with the other side. Many Europeans know full well Russia is an aggressor but rarely use the language. Even worse, other Europeans have lost the language completely. Fifthly, how we think about Russia, or how we don't think about Russia. Paradoxically, our postmodern European intellectual reflexes are often combined with very old and outdated stereotypes, or Weltanschauung. German war guilt is exclusively oriented towards Russia, or interpreting the conflict in Ukraine through the Soviet anti-fascism prison of the 1940s. There are Spaniards fighting in the Donbass to pay back the debts of the Spanish Civil War. I kid you not. Which, to put it politely, is an outdated view of history at best. Anti-Americanism is one of those most dangerous intellectual fossils. The Americans may do many things wrong, but you can see how way too often in Western Europe, everything that happens in Eastern Europe is somehow assumed to be orchestrated in Washington. And Russia plays on this paradigm with great skill. Another fossil is the remnant of German Ostpolitik. Germany has a special term for Russlandverstehen, Russia understandings, although equivalents exist everywhere in Europe. But understanding is precisely what these people don't do. Their type of understanding is a one-way process. There is no critical analysis, just the constant refrain that we must listen to Russia's worries, interests, and legitimate concerns, all treated as objective givens. And this is a broader tendency amongst so-called realist commentators. I used to warn my students about the pitfalls of using the cliché that Russia is different. Now I have to warn them about the pitfalls of using the cliché that Russia is normal, that it's just a normal state defending what anybody would agree are Russian national interests. Many of the tropes, however, that we hear of so often, in the definition of Russian national interests, Russia has been humiliated, the West destroyed the Soviet Union, exploited Russian weakness after the end of the Cold War, have their origin in Russia's structure as a propaganda state. Most of them have only the smallest grain of truth, but we've been so used to hearing them that we almost believe them to be true. In local terminology, Russia is what's called a political technology state. Its day-to-day diet is myth and mythology. Its foreign policy is full of dubious assumptions and fake facts, which we take far too often at face value, as in the current process of reassuring Russia over entirely spurious objections to the trade agreement with Ukraine. Sixth sin. If the fifth was how we don't think intelligently about Russia, the sixth is that we don't really think at all about Ukraine and its neighbours, which are treated in a classic orientalist way. We are used to following Edward Said's invitation to inverse our perspective and see the problems of the Middle East and the Near East as the legacy of empire. But European intellectuals are not so good at doing the same for our other Orient, the European East. Countries like Ukraine have been made triply subaltern. The Eastern Partnership makes it a supplicant of Europe. Russia, of course, behaves towards Ukraine as an imperial power, post-imperial power. But worst of all, Europe all too often views Ukraine through the eyes of Russia, without recognising Moscow's imperial perspective. I've lost count the number of times one reads in Western European newspapers about Russia's legitimate interest in Ukraine. Imagine the same phrase about Britain's legitimate interest in South Asia, or France's legitimate interest in the Maghreb. It's not the kind of thing that is politically correct to say. Ukraine is not allowed to be a subject. This is bad enough at the diplomatic level, as with the notorious Vostok process, to which Ukraine was not even invited. But it also exists at the cultural level, on the level of popular understanding, where all the classic orientalist tropes, crisis, extremism, ethnic hatred, still colour perceptions of events. So the final sin, Europe has the Eastern Partnership, which is a kind of bureaucratic, a classically EU bureaucratic policy. What does Russia have? And I have three pictures that I'd like to share, if the gentleman next. In the West, we are used to using Yalta as a synonym for bad foreign policy, for ignoring the sovereign rights of small states. Just like we say Munich, also to mean bad foreign policy, appeasement or whatever. Russia uses Yalta in a positive way. This is how different Russia is. This monument to the Big Three was unveiled in Yalta itself. Now, Russia has annexed Crimea in February. The statue actually is very, very old. Well, it was several years old, but Ukraine didn't want it. Crimean Tartars certainly didn't want a statue of Stalin in the middle of Crimea. But as you can see, this is openly celebrated. Sergei Naryshkin, chair of the Russian Duma, said recently, by condemning the 1945 Yalta Agreement, the West is deleting from its own history and the history of world diplomacy one of its best and noblest moments. Yalta kept the peace because of its military realism and created a system of international relations that was more effective than the previous one until almost the end of the 20th century. Historically, Yalta was a good thing. The implication is that Russia was a second Yalta. Can we move to the next picture? Yeah, there we go. This is a demonstration in Moscow. The picture may be a bit dark. It shows the same three again: Churchill, Roosevelt, and Stalin. And the line at the bottom is, Roosevelt and Churchill were more clever than Obama because they were prepared to do a deal with Stalin. And one last picture, if we can move on. The consequence of this kind of policy, this is a recruiting station in Moscow, asking for money and volunteers to fight in Ukraine. It says, tomorrow Russia will become bigger. Today, it depends on you exactly how much. There is no doubt Russia will become bigger, that we're looking at your contribution to make it as bigger as possible. So, the final problem is that the Eastern Partnership, a technocratic policy, is faced by this openly stated desire for a second Yalta. The Eastern Partnership, therefore, is at least three gear shifts out of date. It would still have had problems working in a world in which only the EU existed. Its expansion on the cheap free riding on the assumption that the neighbours are prepared to march towards Brussels and do all the hard work themselves. In which case the label is self-defeating. Neighbourhood policy is existentially wrong. The Eastern Partnership also copies the EU's traditional Schuman method. Start with economic transformation at the bottom and political transformation at the top will follow. But in Eastern Europe and the Caucasus, really the problem is the other way around. It's the politics, stupid. Transformation needs to start at the top with corrupt elites and inefficient and more predatory states. Second, the world has changed radically since 2008, since 2009, when the first Eastern Partnership summit was held here in Prague. The EU is much weaker, the USA is more withdrawn. Russia is not necessarily stronger, but it is more competitive. In fact, to be exact, Russian overreach at a time of growing Russian domestic weakness is the precise nature of the problem. But this Russian ambition has more impact and more resonance in an increasingly multipolar world in which the EU's famously postmodern foreign policy project is not only one of many poles of influence, but is increasingly peculiar and clearly unique. Third, the Eastern Partnership is not a partnership. It does nothing to address our own inadequacies, particularly intellectual, particularly our lack of ambition and outward focus. And finally, the current crisis is clearly not just about Ukraine, or even just about Russia. It's not just about losing Eastern Europe. It's about Europe also potentially losing itself. Plenty of EU member states are already rediscovering their inner nativism, native nationalism. Ukraine, you may be surprised to hear, is in some ways an island of multi-ethnic tolerance compared to the toxic nationalisms on either side in Russia and in European states like Hungary. But choice, as I said at the start, depends on circumstances. And those choices will be made both east and west. But if Ukraine fails, because Putin's Russia is so desperate to see it fail, then we will see a much more dangerous downward spiral across borders with nationalisms and protectionisms feeding off one another east and west. I'll stop there and shift mode. Now we'll have a general panel. We have three excellent panellists from the top tier three countries of the Eastern Partnership, Ukraine, Moldova and Georgia. All have been in government, all are excellent men of ideas, so have both to contribute to our debate. I'll ask each in turn to talk for 10 minutes or so, maximum, because we'd like to get to questions as quickly as possible. And we'll follow the order in the programme. So first, representing Ukraine, is Volodymyr, who is a philosopher and journalist. Those of you who want to access the former may find it more difficult. His latest book is in Ukrainian. But those who want to access the latter can find him on Hromadske TV, where he hosts an English language program every Sunday night. Okay, so Volodymyr.
Thank you very much, Andrew.
Microphone.
Because I have a microphone.
Microphone.
Is it working now?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you, Andrew, and thank you for inviting me. And of course, I share many things, many opinions expressed by Andrew. And probably I will try to specify some of them. When we're talking about Ukraine, of course, the first thing we are talking about is a war, and this is a country at war. This is a country in a war. But on the what the war causes, it's now, according to only very conservative figure, it's about over 6,000 deaths. but as I said, it's very conservative figure. But what is even probably sometimes more tragic is that the number of IDPs, the internally displaced persons, the number is over 1,200,000. And 1,200,000 people is basically all their stories, all their particular stories. The story of, because I'm traveling a lot through Ukraine, across Ukraine, through different regions, talking to these people. And one day you meet a girl called Katya who is traveled from Lugansk, eastern Ukraine, to Lviv, western Ukraine. She doesn't have a husband, she has a son who is autist. And she has almost no means to survive. And she's very talented photographer. Another girl who I met in Druzhkivka, who is called Anya, who has a cancer. And for these people, it's very difficult to survive. Because all those people have lost their homes. All those people have lost their jobs. All those people have lost their content. When we're talking about Ukraine, we very often forget this very humanistic and very humane times. So, story. We talk too much probably about geopolitics. And the second thing I would like to stress is probably related to our first panel. We talk a lot about fundamentalism, Islamic fundamentalism. But now we are facing a different type of fundamentalism. This is Russian fundamentalism. This is an Orthodox fundamentalism. I call it sometimes even a very provocative concept probably, but I suggest it even an Orthodox jihad. I tell you a story about a Greek Catholic priest called Tikhon Kurbak, who we met in Lviv, who was in Donetsk, who is a Greek Catholic priest in Donetsk. It appeared that to be a Greek Catholic priest in Donetsk became very dangerous. So he was captured by pro-Russian soldiers or activists. He was kept in prison for 5-6 days with his eyes closed. He was basically tortured because he had a cancer and he had a diabetes and he didn't have the proper treatment. And he was approached many times by propagandists saying that Greek Catholicism has no sense, Greek Catholic faith has no right to be on earth and to be in this. Another story is a woman called Vasilina who I met in Druzhkivka. Druzhkivka is a tiny town in Donbass, close to the front, close to the war, but it's on the Ukrainian side. She's a Protestant, and she was also moved to the underground, to prison, and spent 5 days there. Why? Because she's a Protestant. Why? Because she was helping to the IDPs, to the internally displaced persons. Why I'm talking about these two subjects? Because if you follow one of the recent remarks by Mr. Zakharchenko, who is the leader of this Donetsk People's Republic, the self-proclaimed Donetsk People's Republic, which is supported by Russia, he said recently that he recognizes as a chief of a state, he's considering himself as a chief of a state, four confessions: Islam, Orthodox Church, Catholicism, Islam and Judaism. No place for Greek Catholic, no place for Protestants, no place for Buddhists, for example. This shows a little bit how this Russian fundamentalism is functioning. Because if you look at the people who are fighting on Donbass on the Russian side, sometimes very often you find the so-called Kazakhs, the Kazakhs from Don. And these Kazakhs are considering themselves literally as Voice Christova, as an army of Christ. Their big flag is a flag with the image of Christ. You have also the battalions of the so-called Russian Orthodox Army, Ruska Pravoslavna Army. These people are considering them all other religions, or at least Greek Catholics and Protestants. They consider Greek Catholics or Orthodox from Kyiv Patriarchate or Protestants as either schismatics or sectors. Now consider Ukraine today. Ukraine has Ukrainian society has very support by Jewish community. We have many Jewish among the leaders of the society. Protestants are playing a very, very big role, because I've traveled a lot through the country and I've seen that probably one half or even more of every volunteer organization who is helping the IDPs, the internally displaced persons, the migrants, the activists are Protestants. And you know, it's sometimes it's incredible to see their work. They also work together with Orthodox, together with Greek Catholics. Crimean Tatars, many Crimean Tatars are now in Lviv in Western Ukraine. In Western Ukraine, Lviv is a very traditionalist Catholic, Greek Catholic society. And still you have very interesting cooperation between them. And one of the leading web newspapers in Ukraine is called Ukrainska Pravda, and its editor-in-chief is a very young girl called Sergei Musayev Borodik, who is also from Crimean Tatar origins. So you have all this Jewish, Muslim, Orthodox, Protestants movement, and it's very interesting. Now, if we look at Europe and Russia, I think the differences of logic is apparent. Europe and this pro-European movement in Ukraine is thinking in terms of win-win logic. So everybody should win. Russia is thinking in terms of lose-lose logic. Russia is sure why. I'm trying to explain it. The logic is that you are sure that you're in the battle. You're in the battle of enemies. Therefore, I suggested recently a concept also kind of a little bit provocative. Russia's return to geopolitics is in fact a return to zoopolitics. To politics which considers politics and geopolitics the battle of animals for survival. And in this battle, you either win or you lose, but you will always lose blood. And your aim is to make the other lose more than you. That's the probably one of the explanations of what's going on. Russia is of course losing. Russia is losing from sanctions, etc. But its aim is to make Ukraine, for example, lose much more than Russia. When we come to Europe and Ukraine, I also share many things of what Andrews was saying. It seems to me that the logic, what Europe is missing a little bit, well, it's doing very lots of positive things, okay? But what is missing probably makes it too much accent on the transfer of law, or law transfer. Thinking that basically, if you sign the association agreement, if you start implementing European law, you will change the. But law by itself doesn't change the country, especially in the countries like Andrew very much said, the country then which are very keen to play by the rules. Therefore, for example, when I was suggesting this concept, this contradiction between Europe of rules and Europe of values or Europe of faith, I was saying that both Europe need each other, because Europe of rules need the Europe of values, Europe of faith, Europe of inspiration. Because otherwise you cannot move forward without a vision and without a mission. And Ukrainian example, Moldovan example, Georgian example show that Europe continues to be attractive, that European values are continue to expand. And it's very interesting to see that European values continue to expand, whereas Europe, in terms of security, tries to defend itself. Whereas if you take Russia, Russian values are basically are losing their attractiveness. Nobody is attracted by Russia, even in the near abroad. So in the values, in the terms of values Russia is defending, therefore all the values Russia is suggesting is basically counter values, against Western values. And therefore is attacking military. So it's a very interesting contradiction. But going back to European approach in Ukraine, it's very important to move a little bit farther than this logic of transfer of law and think in terms of European idea in general. Because Ukraine now is a very dynamic society. It's a society of very interesting creative people. It's a society of volunteers who are making really great job. Because Maidan here, Maidan for me, it was also a concept, a metaphor probably, it was a revolution of the giving. When people were giving their money, when people were giving their lives, when people were giving their child, etc. And this is logic of giving is opposing to oligarchic logic of taking, when you take more than you give. So the very good, very important thing for Europe, it seems to me, is to move a little bit farther than this transfer of law and support not only rules, but people, communities, creative people, inspiration people, good people from civil society. The civil society is now booming in Ukraine. And compared to a little bit, probably several years ago, when the only pressure was from outside, the only pressure for reforms, now you have a society who is pressuring from behind. So the authority is now in a position of a sandwich, and it's very good to have a sandwich position when they are under pressure both from outside and from inside. And it's very important to stimulate these initiatives. Europe sometimes spends lots of money for very abstract ideas, which you cannot show. Europe, until recently, supported only state programs, state projects, without supporting civil society, without supporting businesses. And supporting civil society and businesses, it's much less expensive. One particular modest EU project has a budget of 1 million euro. 1 million euro, you take this money, You set up a fund to support civil society initiatives. You distribute grants inside Ukrainian society, I don't know, 10,000 euro, and you stimulate the society, the civil society moving. So it's very important to move away from this kind of a bureaucratic and slow logic of which we talk very often, and to understand that it's not only like, because win-win logic always should imply learn logic. Europe of rules, Europe of values means that both Europe need to learn a little bit from each other. Ukraine has to learn a lot from European Union, specifically how to follow rules, but European Union also has to learn a lot from Ukraine who is fighting for values, which is kind of a very, very unusual in our time. And learn from Ukrainian society is also to stimulate it, because you will not have a transformation only by, you know, signing an association agreement. You will always have a transformation when you kind of support this mobile, these changing minorities. Because every change, every social change comes from the mobile changing minorities, inspirational minorities. And now we have many of these inspirational minorities in Ukraine, they need support. And it's there who are able to change the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Volody. Our second panelist is Tornike Gordadze, who was Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs of Georgia and then Minister for European and Euro-Atlantic Integration, and therefore extremely expert on this subject. He now works at the French Institute for Higher National Defense Studies in Paris.
Thank you. Can you hear me? It's okay. Thank you very much, Andrew. And of course, I'm happy to be here, and I thank the organizing committee of this meeting. I will try to stick to the title of this panel and to answer what is the EU to its neighbors and namely for Georgians and Georgia. I will start with a very normal and not very original way, saying that for the Georgians, or many of them, most of them, Europe is a synonym of stability, democracy, rule of law, absence of corruption, wealth, and development. And again, and very importantly, also an alternative model to what is suggested by Russia. There's no third way in the region. There are only two possible ways: the European way and the Russian way. So we shouldn't be naive to think that okay, there can be a third model. I hear that every day in France, maybe this European model for these countries, especially for Ukraine, Georgia, Moldova, was too early and.
We didn't associate Russia to this model, and that's why we have a problem. So maybe that there could be something in the middle. So saying that means that you don't really know the situation in the region. For the Georgians, and I'm sure now for the Ukrainians and for the Moldovans, unfortunately, Russia represents a model that is a synonym of just the contrary of what I mentioned before. The absence of the rule of law, corruption, arbitrariness, oligarchs, nationalism, some religious extremism, all this post-Soviet mix of things. And this is something that many Georgians don't want to see in their country. When I said many, it's still the majority, but things are changing. But in the last 10 years, things were changing in a different way. So they started from after the Groza Revolution, that was a fight against the post-Soviet model. So Georgia, as Ukraine, as Moldova, as Azerbaijan, as even Russia, was after the collapse of the Soviet Union. There was a brief period of very strong confrontation with the Soviet legacy, and then it became a classical post-Soviet country under the President Shevardnadze. It means that it was a kind of country ruled by the old bureaucracy that just changed their appearance. They just abandoned communist ideology, but at the end it was the same elites that succeeded in capturing all economic resources, and they were corrupt, and the country was not a functioning state. It became a failed state. And the revolution was against that, and also was against this conception of the society of the role of Georgia in the region, trying to imagine the country as being promoting its own destiny and not following blindly Russia. In 10 years, from 2003, 2004 to 2012, 2013, there was a tremendous progress in terms of Georgians, in terms of considering Europe. So Georgians felt themselves as being European much more than before, and that was thanks to a great kind of Kulturkampf. It was not only just a promotion of Europe, but it was a serious fight inside the society, promoting, with the help of the state, a different narrative of Georgian, even national history, even architecture, even ways of being, or even of body languages sometimes, to imagine Georgia, and I'm underlining imagine, because I'm not talking about realities that are current. Just imagining Georgia as a European country, and just destroying or putting on the second level all what linked Georgia to the Soviet or even to the Russian past. And that was a kind of success. I'm not saying that everything was a success during the 10 years of the previous government, but that was a success. Now we have in Georgia a strong percentage, important percentage of people who believe that themselves are, that they are European. And they feel much closer to the people who live in Eastern Europe or Central Europe or the Balkans than to those former Soviet citizens of Central Asia. Or even some of the very neighboring countries, I would name them. And this was something that was quite evident. EU was also trying to be more engaged, especially after the Rose Revolution, and to mobilize to defend its values, but this mobilization was, I wouldn't say partial and limited. We saw its limits in 2008 during the war with Russia, and we saw its limits with the Russia-Ukraine conflict that started last year. On the other hand, European Union, of course, promoted human rights, minority rights, and rule of law. We had very intensive human rights dialogue taking place very frequently with our European colleagues. But at the same time, we felt more pressure on us than on Russians on some issues. I'll tell just an example. 2 years ago, or 3 years ago, Russia became a WTO member.
And Georgia was the last country that was opposing Russia's WTO membership because of the just the occupation of the Abkhazians of the South Ossetia and just violation of all international trade rules in Georgia, and also with the abusive behavior in terms of international commerce, embargoes, etc., etc. Georgia was the last country, but there was a tremendous interest in Western Europe and in the United States to have Russia on WTO. We felt a tremendous pressure from the European Union and the US together. We were crushing under the pressure to permit Russia to become WTO member, because of course there was a big interest, and also there was an explanation that once they are member, they will be, they have to respect rules, and that will make Russia more civilized. You saw what's happened since this decision of 2011-2012, or in any other international involvement of Russia didn't bring this country respect more international rules. So now things are a little bit changing in Georgia, because the last survey I have read was the survey conducted by the NDI, and we saw that the guys who think like me and who believe that Europe has no alternative now are 68%, which is a good percentage, of course. But those who believe that Eurasian Union can be an alternative, they are already 31%. They were 16% last year, and they were less than 10% two or three years ago. So you see the dynamics. And we can explain that by two reasons. First is that the people don't see a carrot from the European side. That was the disappointment on visa liberalization issues, and also on European perspective issues. Second reason is that since the change of government in Georgia, and that was a very positive thing in 2012 when there was a peaceful transfer of power, Georgia has a government that is, I wouldn't say they are against Europe, of course they consider that, they continue to consider Europe as being priority, but at the same time Yanukovych was also considering Europe as priority. There is no government that will fight for that, that will fight for the absence of alternative to the European way. And this is something that is new. So today we have a government that is more classical post-Soviet government that would see the balance of powers, and at the end, I wouldn't say that it's impossible today for this government to fail on the other side. And to finish, and of course the also main difference with the previous years is that in the previous years the Russian way was not an alternative. There were no diplomatic relations, there was a war, etc. And there was a strong engagement from the government to not to allow Russian soft power in the country. Today, and Jacques Hubnik has mentioned the strength of Russian soft power, especially in media, and lots of small NGOs and groups popped up in Georgia, were financed directly from Georgia, from Russia, and they are gaining momentum, especially after the disillusionments and disappointments of the last years with the European Union. And the Riga summit was another disappointment in the country. And last point, I'm also a French citizen, and I see that one of the main problems of the lack of engagement of Europe in this region are just the absence of coherence sometimes in European action in this region. Is we have to find it in the perception of that the Europeans themselves, the citizens of European Union member states have of Europe. And this is something that is also changing in a very bad direction. As I said, I live in France and I work in French academia, and I have the impression that today European idea in France is very unpopular. I'm not talking about the Eastern Partnership, which is something that is even more negative for many people, but even European idea. And this is thanks to, because of two things. First, the bureaucrats or technocrats are unable to explain why Europe is important. And second, the politicians
who consider Europe as something very convenient to put the blame on it, on everything, any problem, internal problems, immigration, economic development, etc., etc. So European idea is dying and is becoming increasingly unpopular inside Europe. And we, I think all people who are in favor of Europe and Europe's engagement in the East or in the South first have to act inside European member states, and especially in Western Europe. I'm not talking about Baltics and Poland, where we have to help this idea to survive. Otherwise, everything is useless. I will stop. Thank you.
Thank you. Our final speaker is Julian Groza, who was also Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs and European Integration in his own country, Moldova, and now works at the Institute for European Policies and Reforms, a new cutting-edge Moldovan think tank.
Thank you very much. And I'll try to be short, as my colleagues here have more or less described more or less the same ideas I wanted to put here from them. But I will still focus in my 7 to 10 minutes presentation on mainly on three things. What Europe or what EU is today for Moldova and for countries like Ukraine and Georgia. And then I will conclude with what should EU be for these countries. And of course, in answering to these two questions, I'll try to explain the challenges that the EU and the neighbors are confronted with. So first of all, today EU has a very fragmented policy with a lack of imagination, a lack of vision towards countries like Eastern Partnership, in particular countries like Moldova, Georgia, and Ukraine. And this is more or less influenced by two factors, to my mind. One is this fatigue, internal fatigue in the European Union, economic crisis, migration, and so forth. And the second, it's basically influenced by the fear of not upsetting Russia. And here, I mean, the simple example is, I have been part of the negotiation teams on Eastern Partnership Declaration since Prague, Warsaw, Vilnius. I also took part in the exercise that we together tried to do with our Ukrainian and German colleagues at the beginning of this year to develop for the first time a joint vision for Eastern Partnership Summit Agreement. And, in Prague, this partnership had in fact, two main objectives. One, it was about political association and economic integration, and second was about really the mobility. This is more or less what Jacques Rubin was saying. As we speak today, these three countries more or less have complied with these objectives, or are on the way to comply. Moldova is currently the country which citizens are able to travel freely from Lisbon to Vladivostok, having visa-free travel to EU. Most of our citizens already got used to that fact, so it's nothing, something unusual for them. More than 500,000 citizens already benefited from that. We have the agreement in place, we have the CFTA area with the European Union, we implemented. Normally, if to look logically, this policy, everything is done. I mean, Moldova is a success story in terms of the implementation of the objectives, and so on and so forth. What happened after the elections in Moldova, the recent elections in November, and a little bit before that, it was that we have seen, in fact, a decrease in popularity of the European idea. And at the same time, an increase of popularity of the Eurasian Union. This is more or less what Tornike was saying, but in our case it's even more complicated. The NDI survey from the beginning of this year was showing something like 39% support for European integration in Moldova and about 55% for Eurasian Union. And then, of course, one should think something went wrong. On one hand, everything was promised in 2009 when this pro-European governments were in power, was delivered. Moldovan citizens are able to travel to the European Union to see the values, benefit from them. We can trade with the European Union, we can use this market, huge market for our products, especially in the situation when Russia has embargoed our goods already for 2 years. But what happened is actually that we have seen a decrease. And one of the reasons, I'm sure, it is, I mean, there are two main reasons, one external and one internal. And the most important reason is the quality of the political elites in Moldova. And corruption, of course. So, this actually contributed to the disappointment of the citizens in the European idea, because this European idea was associated with these corrupted politicians. Although, in fact, everything went fine and reforms are implemented and the laws are adopted, but in reality, things are not changing and citizens do not feel that. And having this situation, it is a very fertile soil for propaganda, which is projected by the Russian Federation through media, and we have more than almost 30% of our citizens are Russian-speaking minorities. And although about 25% there are pensioners who remember the Soviet times, and normally these people just watch Russia 24 or Первый канал or Russia, and every time when you try to convince them of something else, that there is a new, different reality, I mean, it's in vain, because they go home and they start turning the same TV and propaganda is washing their heads and so on. This week, our audiovisual council have suspended the transmission of Russia 2024. Is it too late? Is it correct or not? It remains to be seen. And I also have seen from my practical example, when I was going to the villages and trying to communicate about what government is doing, what about Europe, what about our relations with Russia, who is our friend, who is our supporter. And after two and a half hours, I was seeing in the eyes of these people some kind of light, and they were like more enthusiastic. But as I said, after I was leaving, they were turning on the TV and again Russia 24 or Berlin. Or even worse, in the last 2 years, we have seen an increase of parties, pro-Russian parties, financed by Russia, indirectly or directly, which are increasing their popularity. I mean, one party which appeared from night, I mean, overnight and participated in the election, they got 25% of the votes, the socialists. And during the campaign, they used billboards with Putin and the leader of this party sitting at the same table. And that is in a situation when the war in Ukraine was going. And that is in a situation when the biggest minority in Moldova is Ukrainian. So, definitely we have a problem. Here, I mean, we are in Riga. Unfortunately, what we have seen in this text of the declaration, even though we tried, I mean, there was an idea to have a shorter declaration, but what we have, in fact, what happened, even longer paragraphs, longer phrases, many words, just covering the inability to confront with reality. And the lack of imagination, indeed. So this soft power, unfortunately, is not enough. And the biggest challenge is that this soft power is not becoming mellow. What should be, and I will conclude with what should EU do now? Definitely, EU is still a center of gravity, kind of, this Europe, Magneto Europa. I'm sure it is. Because still the majority of our population, they are supporters of European values, because the pro-European parties have won in the last elections. What we should focus now, and I liked what Andrew was saying about what should be the focus of the European Union, should be the economy, should be the objective. I think it should be both, the economy and corruption. And the EU should take more responsibility in engaging and helping these countries in order to fight high-level corruption and to exercise more pressure on the governments to fight corruption. And for us, it's easier to feel the sense of that because we are very close. I mean, we are neighbors with Romania. And in the last years, we have seen a lot of oligarchs, a lot of high-level officials in prison. And that is producing an increased impact, not only in Romania, but also in Moldova. I mean, one of the sayings, which is very popular around Moldova, DNA, which is the prosecutor office from Romania responsible for fight corruption on high level, DNA moved to Moldova, move over Prut, which is the region of Moldova. It's becoming more and more. And then in the last few months, we have seen that these popular movements, which are started civic movements, which are non-political, apolitical, they are gathering more and more support. And I have been attending one of those events, and it was apolitical, and I have seen crowds of people on the main street requesting the government to fight corruption, and more importantly, to clear up the situation with the banking sector, which was affected in the last year heavily, and that affected actually the whole image of our politicians, because there were different suspicions that many of those who were actually ruling and were involved in that process. So you should be more engaged. You should take more responsibility and focus more on development, of course. Lower down the help to civil society, as Volodymyr was saying, and also more importantly to the local administration, to create platforms of interaction between civil society, active people on the local level, local public administration, businessmen, so that they focus on building up their communities, and on the central level, of course, fighting corruption, justice reform is crucial. And one of the ideas we had last year was to bring in Moldova a mission of European judges and prosecutors, which would work with our judges and prosecutors and make them basically more accountable for the work they're doing. Because otherwise, as we're seeing things happening, I mean, the laws are good, the reforms are good, the strategies are good, but the problem is with the implementation. And one other buzzword, which is very becoming very widespread, is that the category of failed states transformed into a captive state because of the link between the oligarchs and the politicians. And the problem, and actually the main task now for the Moldovan society will be to make enough pressure on the government to make sure that all the commitments on the implementation of the reform agenda, which is described in the association agreement, are implemented, and to make enough pressure on them also through the European Union to make sure that justice and corruption is justice is ensured and corruption is fought in reality. And one more point, Andrew, which is also very important, which we haven't seen it in Riga Summit, but it is really important because people in our countries really need the light at the end of the tunnel. And it was really encouraging, the message that I have seen from Commissioner Hahn these days, that he would propose some kind of a plan of preparing these countries for the moment when they get a membership perspective. And I think it's a good idea, because in our case, in Moldova worked. I remember 2009 when there was very big skepticism in many EU countries, but also in my country, that Moldova would get visa-free travel to the European Union. But we insisted and we got the conditions and we implemented them and we got it. And now we are able to travel. And there is no risk to any country in Europe from our citizens traveling freely to the European Union. I believe the same approach, conditionality to reform agenda, with be the best tool to push up reforms agenda in this country, focusing on the models of transformation more than trying to antagonize European Union with Russia, I think it's more effective. So I thank you for that.
Thank you. I would love to comment, but that would eat up time, so we'll go straight to questions. I guess the organisers will tell me how long we have, hopefully a reasonable amount of time as we started late. A gentleman with the mic is on tour. We'll take them in batches of three or four. Gentleman there first, and then the lady in the middle, third row, second.
Just a reminder, until the 15, okay?
15.
Thank you.
Please identify yourself.
My name is Pavel Fischer. You are representing three countries which are occupied by a foreign country and whose territory is dismantled somehow. You have also experience of government responsibility, two of you. Imagine a possibility, imaginative possibility that you could propose awarding, for instance, for Madame Merkel before she meets Vladimir Putin. What should be the phrase you put in her papers? How to address the territory of yours, which is not under control of your governments? So, in other words, what should be the draft of the message you would like to see? To be put forward by very important representative of European country. Thank you.
Thank you. And could you pass the microphone to the lady on the third row?
Good afternoon. My name is Karine Janton, and I am a European citizen with a French passport but happened to live in Prague for 20 years. I would like to, you know, quote what you just said, that people need to see the light at the end of the tunnel. I think, you know, the second gentleman mentioned also that politicians are using Europe as a scapegoat. My parents and grandparents went through two world wars, one world war, and if I recall correctly, Europe was built on migration and immigration. I would like people to remind every one of us, I don't know anybody with a pure something, I'm not a pure French, I'm not a pure anything, we all come with a mixed blood of Europe. Instead of kind of bringing Europe and saying this is the mistake of welcoming people, not welcoming people, can we tell everyone how we can remind it that we are strong together as a mix of people? So whoever is in charge and can do this, can we have a bit of light at the tunnel and telling us that we are strong together, not by kicking each other out of the country when we can? Thank you.
Thank you. Is there a third question? So the other two? No. So, Jeff, who would like to go first? There's no order, well, please. Well, the territory is most occupied.
Yeah, these guys are having privilege to.
Mine is most occupied. Yeah, so maybe
it's what message to Merkel? I think the major message is basically that this is not the end of the game. This is not the end of Russian expansion. Because for me it's very important also, when I talk about Ukraine, I also talk about Georgia, I also talk about Moldova and Transnistria. And when you look at these cases, you see that this is a game that is repeated all the time in the same scenario. So for example, first, you have to provoke a kind of something that you will call a civil war. And then, after you provoke this, due to some provocateurs, due to some KGB officers, FSB officers, due to some, pro-Russian NGOs, then you provoke a conflict and then you intervene. And you intervene only to protect. Because Russia only intervenes to protect. You know, but you know, in order to intervene to protect, you should have some elements of the civil war. Like if you take even fascists, right? Remember what Alexander Lebed, the Russian general, was saying 92, I guess. It was the same rhetoric, the Moldova's a fascist, whatever else. So it's always like that, and it's going, moving forward and forward, and this is a not a singularist, isolated cases, but this is a strategy, and the strategy is to revise the world order, to have a new Yalta, to reconquer the space of the Soviet Union, etc., etc. And imagine, it's always like an alternative history, imagine what would be if Ukraine collapses, then you will have to go to Baltics, then he will go to Baltics, he will go to Central Europe, etc. As to light inside the tunnel, well, when I'm talking to Western Europeans, I'm always like trying to explain to them also the alternative history. Like, what would it be if you don't have this Europe of, you know, of free movement, etc., etc.? What would it be if you have a war? What would it be if you have this situation when the xenophobic forces just put you in jail just because you're a Protestant or you're a Greek Catholic? So I think Europe is sometimes too much concerned about security. And if you're Western Europe, and if you are too much concerned about security, any single element of insecurity makes you frustrated. Whereas what Ukrainian events are showing to us, when you're losing sometimes your friends on the front during the war, when even speak about economy, like when Ukrainians are listening about talks about European crisis, it's like a funny game because Ukrainian currency lost 3 times. Right? So this is probably the crisis, right? But this is not the most awful thing we have, because you have 1 million of displaced persons who lost their hope, and they still have a hope. Because I've met many communities, and you can't even imagine how sometimes positive they are, how smiling they are. They are living in a classroom, like a community is living in a classroom of a school. You got 50, 60 people. They don't have rooms. They just separate themselves with little riddles, with little curtains. And they still are able to smile, they still are able to think about the future, etc. I think it's very important to see that basically even people with lots of sorrow and lots of bad things in their lives are looking forward.
Right.
Yes.
I
will start with the first question about the wording to adopt for occupation. And very concretely, in the association agreement text I was negotiating with the Europeans, there was no mention of the conference at all. So we have like 12 rounds to create a chapter, a Georgia-EU association agreement on the conflict, and we were fighting to put the word occupation or illegal presence of foreign forces. We failed. We failed because the European Union said we need a consensus, and there is no consensus among 28 countries to put the word occupation. They put lots of things that respect of territorial integrity within the international recognized borders, the right of the refugees to come back, etc., etc., and all this with lots of fights, friendly fights, of course. But there was no possibility to put military occupation or illegal presence of foreign troops in the text of the association agreement. It took us 2 years, and at the end it was until the very last moment we were negotiating that, and we didn't get it. So it's very easy to if we want to discuss this issue, is to use the right words, to say that this is an occupation, and now what happens in South Ossetia and Abkhazia, it's almost an annexation, because they even don't have, the room for maneuver for these so-called independent countries is much less than the room for maneuver they had before this independence, recognized independence. They virtually don't have armed forces of anything. So this is something that can be, of course, used. And of course, Another issue is that Europeans, and this is Merkel or anybody, should understand also, this is not the war with Georgia and also with Ukraine, is not, or in Moldova, is not about territories. Russia doesn't need territories. That was the main conquest, etc. The idea of fighting against these countries was to make these attempts to reform, to become more European fail. This is still the objective. So the answer from the European Union or European big players should be not because you are trying to fail to make these experiences fail, we will engage even more. Because if you say, oh no, there is a conflict and we will not engage in this conflict, that means that they already won. The answer should be no, you want to fail these experiences, we will engage even more, even including with the occupied population, etc., etc. And the right and the light at the end of the tunnel, of course, this is something that is terribly needed for people to make them accept all these efforts, because they are ready to make even more efforts. But if there is no perspective, that the pro-Russian forces are just booming after that. After Riga, in Georgia, there was hundreds of publications and articles, etc. So they are lying. They are promising, so Europeans are promising a lot of good things they never deliver. Russia is promising sometimes bad things, but they always deliver. Bad and good. So this is the difference.
I don't know what should be in those lines. I try to think, but do you think I at the same time, I have to tell you that we should start from what is in the mind of this guy? Because Mr. Putin has an agenda about the airport. And he's implementing his agenda. And it's right like Tornike said, it's not about territories, it's about influence. And it's more than influence, it's about rebuilding the power of Russia and trying to get back what it was lost. Because, I mean, what was Mr. Putin saying sometimes 2007, I think, was said that the biggest tragedy of the 20th century was the dissolution of the Soviet Union. And what was his first action after he became president in Russia? He changed the anthem. To Soviet Union was entered, although the words are different. So the point is that I'm sure that Russia has an agenda. My question is, does the EU have an agenda? Because we have seen, I have seen this table of who discussed on the phone more from world readers of Mr. Putin. Mrs. Merkel had the biggest numbers of phone conversations. I mean, does it help or not? I mean, do we want this second Ribbentrop-Molotov pact? What do we want? So the point is that I think you should understand that Russia is not playing football like EU is believing. Playing football and asks Russia to play by rules. Russia is playing rugby, if not boxing. So I think first thing which should be done, not to suggest Mrs. Merkel, but to say to Mr. Putin, because I'm sure she knows more than we do what to say to him. The problem is whether EU can have a united voice and can project, first, have a strategy, and second, to project the strategy, because what is Russia is doing is playing in a way using the issues in our countries and as well at the same time Russia perfectly knows how EU functions, perfectly knows, but unfortunately EU doesn't know how Russia is functioning. So these are the more provocative. Elements that I would like to bring to you before sending some notes to Mrs. Merkel to tell Putin.
Okay, we could carry on. It would be great to talk about Russia and football. today, but I see the organisers are trying to get us to wrap up, so I'm sure you will also ask for thanks in the traditional manner. Thank you.